Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.
Good morning, and welcome to December's Building Green. My name is Bill Vitale. I'm your host. I have no guest today, so you have to listen to my wisdom for a half hour. The topic today is climate change. There's been a lot in the news lately about it. A recent report released on December 5th by the Global Carbon Project has found that global emissions of carbon dioxide have reached the highest levels on record. No surprise to many of us. Between 2014 and 2016, emissions remained largely flat, which was a hopeful sign. But those hopes were dashed in 2017. The report finds that emissions have increased by 1.6%, and the projection for 2018 is 2.7%. This is the latest evidence that there's a chasm between international goals for climate change, combating climate change, and the actions being taken by countries. If we could bring up the first image, this graph shows. So you could see that it's the line is moving ever upward, and it's taken a little bit of a sharp curve in the last year, or is projected for 2018. I don't want to spend a lot of time on the graph, but if you review the program, anyway, this is the source is the Global Carbon Project, so you can actually go to the report and look at this graph. So things are not going in the direction that we want them to be going. We'd either like to see that level off or go down. Earlier this fall, there was an alarming report from the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC. There was a landmark United Nations report that also painted a dire picture of immediate consequences of climate change, that it's more serious and more acute than we previously thought, and said that avoiding damage requires quickly transforming the world economy. It describes a world of worsening food shortages and wildflowers, mass die-off of coral reefs as soon as 2040, not the deep horizon. You can read this report at, actually if you could bring up now, if you could bring up those, the links. The first two addresses, well, the first one's an address. The second one, just Google New York Times climate IPCC, and many options will come up for seeing both the New York Times article about it, which is very good, a good digest, maybe easier than reading the report itself. The first link on the screen is to the report itself, for those of you who want to tackle that. I had previously planned to do an expanded discussion of this report this month, but in the meantime, the federal government, the U.S. government, the Trump administration, has issued its own report with similar conclusions. These are more specific to the U.S., also include a regional analysis, regions of the United States, as well as a huge focus on how it'll impact the economy. This document, called the National Climate Assessment, was issued on November 23rd, and it's about the effect of climate change on and its damage to the environment and its impact on food and health, and as I mentioned, the negative impact it will have on our economy. Before I go on, if you could bring up those links again. If you want to see that report, you can go to the third item on there that's underlined. The report is actually very user-friendly. It's broken down. It's graphically, it looks great. It's not intimidating by any stretch, but there's just so much information on there. And if you want, you can go specifically to the Northeast and find out what's going on in our area. Interestingly enough, probably to no surprise, the Trump administration tried to bury the report, releasing it on the Friday after Thanksgiving. And I really thought that was going to be the end of it. But maybe it's because of where we are in this country at this point or in the world, but it did not work to bury it. There's been attention given to it way beyond what I expected. including a lengthy front page story a few days later in the Reading Eagle on December 4th. You can go to their website and find that, I'm sure. And then a few days later, the Eagle had an editorial calling for action on climate change. There have been numerous other pieces in the Eagle online. Even today, there was a letter to the editor to the Reading Eagle, and countless articles in the New York Times and all kinds of other places. So it's not very hard to find it. And because of the response, as the month went on, I had to keep changing the focus of this program. I originally was going to focus on convincing people of how serious this is, but I think that that we're beyond that, or that we need to pay attention to it. So I think that's already being done. What I would like to do is focus on the contents of the report, some of the highlights, just in case we need a little bit of a boost to get out and do something about it, and then to talk about some of the things that we can be doing to do something about it. And a lot is being done about it. Can we play the first clip? Before you start that, this clip is from an event that took place a week ago. It was called the Global Climate Summit Town Hall Meeting, which I believe Senator Bernie Sanders was the main impetus, but a lot of other people helped organize it. It was on, I'll give you some information about that in a minute. But if we could play that clip, this is from the opening of that event.
A dire warning this morning from climate experts. A UN panel says governments around the world must take rapid action to curb rising temperatures, or else millions around the world face future disaster.
A record-breaking heat wave, and things just keep getting worse.
Wildfires rage as far north as the Arctic Circle.
A suffocating severe heat wave.
Things like tornadoes, which you normally don't get.
At least 24 deaths have been blamed on the storm.
Record rainfall is devastating entire communities.
My neighbor called me up and he was like, the fire's at the edge of our community. And he said, I'm going to go out there right now with some shovels and a hose to try and put the fires out because the fire department was just spread too thin.
I know from the facts as a senior climate scientist that climate change is real and it's affecting us now.
The good news is that all over the world, people are beginning to figure that out and beginning to step up.
There are alternatives to using intensive carbon-based fuels. We should be moving in that direction.
Never before has there been such a unifying issue as climate change.
The time is now. We don't have any more time.
It's all about everyday people coming together and believing in their ability to change this country.
For me, that has meant plugging my voice into the legal and the justice system to hold our government accountable.
I'm willing to go to prison for this planet, and I'm willing to go again and again and again until I see some results, until we all see a better world.
The hope is in the resistance.
Who will stand with me now for mine and future generations to inherit a healthy, just, and sustainable planet? Who will stand with me now?
So those brief clips of some of the included some of the individuals that are among the leaders in the climate change movement now. Some have recently emerged. Some like Bill McKibben and Van Jones have been around for a long time. So we'll see another clip from part of that conference later in the program. But let's go to some of the highlights of this report. As I said, it's called the National Climate Assessment. 13 federal agencies, 300 experts, guided by a 60-member federal advisory committee, created this report, which is 1,656 pages long. As I said, the conclusions are worse than we thought. It must be said that the heft of this report, not only its how thick it is, but the fact that 300 experts and 13 federal agencies participated in the creation of it, did not prevent Trump from discounting it, including its warnings about the effect of climate change on the economy. The report outlines devastating effects on changing climate on the economy, health, and the environment, including record wildfires in California, crop failures in the Midwest, crumbling infrastructure in the South, and atmospheric pollutants like ozone and smoke, which can lead to respiratory problems and premature death. I just want to look at three images that were included with the account of this. Can you bring up the first image? This is an oil refinery in Port Arthur, Texas. I'm going to read the caption to the right. President Trump has pushed to roll back regulations on carbon emissions. If he had his way, we'd see more and more of this. This was fighting the campfire this past month in Magalia, California. I guess I pronounced that right. And then the third image. This is the flooding that occurred in 2011, which forced the Calhoun Nuclear Power Station near Omaha to shut down for years. So those images are just showing some of the weather-related catastrophes that we have been facing and that the report predicts are just going to increase. Both this and the IPCC report, both of them have predicted that they're going to be more frequent, more severe, and more widespread if we don't do something about it. It concludes that if significant steps are not taken to rein in global warming, there will be a 10% drop in the American economy by the end of the century. Again, this is the National Climate Assessment. These findings are directly at odds with the Trump administration's agenda of environmental deregulation. President Trump asserts deregulation will spur economic growth. The report, to no surprise, says the opposite. So what impact will it have on the economy? A reduction in American exports. Supply chains could be affected. Agricultural yields could fall to 1980 levels by mid-century. The fire season could spread to the southeast. It also includes sections for each region of the country. Agricultural impact. Rising temperatures, extreme heat, drought, wildfires on range lands, and heavy downpours are expected to disrupt agricultural activity. This may be more acute and widespread in the Midwest, but we've seen stories of how some of these changes have already affected Berks County farmers. There's been accounts in the newspaper, more than one. The previous climate change assessment in 2014 helped inform the Obama administration as it wrote a series of landmark climate change regulations. In 2016, the Trump and the Republicans campaigned against these regulations, moved decisively since the election to roll back the regulations, clearly the wrong direction. As I mentioned, the report covers every region of the U.S. No area, including the Northeast, will go untouched. Droughts will curb hydropower and stress already limited water supplies in the Southwest. Loss of sea ice will cause coastal flooding and erosion and force communities to relocate in Alaska. With sea level rise, coastal cities like Miami and South Carolina have already been experiencing what's being called nuisance flooding. You've probably seen images of Miami, people driving around through 6 or 8 inches of water. This is not during a flood, high tide, I guess. Wildfires will become more common in the Southeast. Disruption to fisheries in New England and the Northwest have already started. The Midwest and the Northeast will experience more flooding. We are already experiencing increases in rainfall and intensity, and that's projected to get worse. Now, the section on the Northeast. The changing seasons are already affecting the region's rural industries, such as tourism, farming, and forestry. The changing coastal and ocean habitats will impact commerce, tourism, and recreation, not to mention the way of life. Again, already impacting that. The more extreme weather, the warmer temperatures, degradation of air and water, quality and sea level rise will lead to additional health-related problems and costs and lower quality of life. Heat waves will lead to more deaths, and a hotter climate will lead to more outbreaks of disease. We've already seen the increased number of Lyme disease cases and West Nile virus in southeastern Pennsylvania. Not a pretty picture. The report emphasizes will the U.S. and other nations take action to mitigate warming? I think I have a typo here. Anyway, it puts forth three principal actions that can be taken by the public sector to address the issue. Number one imposing a tax or fee on greenhouse gas emissions, basically on companies that release CO2 in the atmosphere. You can figure out who they are. Number two, establishing regulatory limits on how much greenhouse pollution can be emitted. And three, spending money on clean energy research. This does not mean, so those are three core things that are in the National Climate Assessment. This does not mean that things are not being done already. The following short clip reviews some of the efforts that are being taken around the world. Can we run that second clip?
The globe faces an unprecedented crisis. The United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has informed us that we have 12 short years to bring this entire planet together to make a massive transformation of our energy system and global economy, and only 30 years to completely eliminate carbon pollution emissions. Critics will say that this is unrealistic, but it's actually already happening all over the world. While no country on Earth is where we need to be, there are countries who are moving in the right direction to take immediate and aggressive action to combat climate change. China certainly has significant political and environmental problems, but it has already installed a little bit more than double the total amount of solar as the United States, and recently became the biggest solar country in the world. China raised its 2020 solar target to 5 times the total amount of electricity that the United States produces from all sources. China has achieved this explosive growth by employing the largest renewable energy workforce in the world, 4.2 million people, which is nearly 40% of the total number of renewable workers in the world. And it's not just China. The European Union released a plan to eliminate carbon emissions by 2050. One of the European Union's member states, Sweden, has released a plan to stop using fossil fuels altogether by 2030 and eradicate all carbon pollution emissions by 2050. France is investing over $9 billion per year to triple its onshore wind power capacity and multiply its solar power generation fivefold by 2030. In 2017, Brazil and India joined China to account for 63% of the world's renewable energy investments, around $143 billion. India is now producing the cheapest electricity in the world through solar and wind plants. This is a pivotal moment for the United States. We cannot continue to abandon our fellow humans all over the globe. We must lead the fight to cut carbon pollution emissions and create millions of jobs.
Okay, so that was another clip that was part of something called the Climate Change Town Hall. As I said, all you need to do is plug in those words or Climate Change Town Hall Bernie Sanders. Go to YouTube and you'll see it. It's about an hour and three quarters long. Those were video clips that were part of it. The town hall itself is a panel discussion with guests, different experts coming in and talking about what's happening in their particular sector. So there's a lot to learn from it. So I feel, and I hope I've made the case by reviewing some of the contents of the National Climate Assessment, I feel like we are at a crisis point, and we need to start acting pretty boldly immediately. So what does that mean? We need to be active in our personal lives. And you've heard it many, many times over, but we need to be taking initiatives such as driving more fuel-efficient cars, turning the thermostat down, adding insulation, installing solar panels, buying green energy, buying local food, growing our own food, et cetera, et cetera. These are good, and they're important for us to do, but as the report indicates, these are not enough. So we need to get involved beyond what we do in our own personal lives, and that means getting involved politically to change policy. We need to hold the fossil fuel companies accountable. A recent study concluded that 90 fossil fuel companies like Koch Industry, Chevron, and Duke Energy are responsible for 2/3 of the observed increases in global surface temperatures. That's astounding. So this is where the pressure needs to be applied. There are a number of organizations you can get involved with, 350.org, sunrisemovement.org, or 350.org is actually the organization. If you go to 350.org, their website, you can find out some of the things they're doing, such as a movement to keep fossil fuels in the ground. Another organization is the Sunrise Movement, which is an organization a youth-led organization. They were the ones protesting in the halls of Congress a couple of weeks ago. but you can find what they're doing at sunrisemovement.org. There are many others. Locally, there is an organization that's fighting pipelines, which is all part of this process. And that's and if you go to berksgastruth.org, you can find out how to get involved with them. There are legal battles being waged, challenges to pipelines and other development that foster the use of fossil fuels, the extraction, movement, use of fossil fuels. We need to work to elect people at the state, federal, I'd say local level, including a new president who will move on policies to rein in the polluters and combat climate change. One of those that is nascent and I think is with the now having a Democratic control of the House of Representatives may gain more steam, and this is something called the Green New Deal. You can write to your congressperson to support the Green New Deal and other similar legislative initiatives. Luckily, in Reading and parts of Berks County, we have a new representative, Chrissy Houlihan, who gets this, who does not think it's a hoax, who thinks that we need to do something about climate change. So those of us in her district can talk to her. The representative that represents most of northern Berks, moving up into Schuylkill County, whose name I believe is Musser, is somebody who's going to need some pressure and a lot of pressure. So I encourage you to get involved with these groups. Losing my place, but now I've just found it. Another initiative that is happening is called the Drawdown Project. The Drawdown is a point in time when the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere begins to decline on a year-to-year basis. The central premise is not only to cap CO2 levels, but to actually reduce them through a variety of means. And an exciting aspect of the study and the initiative, or the project, is a couple of hundred scientists identified solutions that are achievable from a practical standpoint. This is quite an exhaustive study and project. The top 10 points, which I will recite real quickly but not go into anything more because a program was done on BCTV, refrigerant management, which is air conditioning, wind turbines, reducing food waste, very interesting, eating a plant-rich diet, protecting our tropical forests, educating girls and family planning. You have to go to the site to read on why that's important, but that's one of the biggest areas where we can have an impact. Solar farms, silvopasture, which is basically regenerative and sustainable agriculture, and rooftop solar. If you want to know more, you can go to bctv.org's YouTube channel and link to Centering on Peace Project Drawdown. This is a program that was done last month on BCTV. If you go to the website, if you could bring that up now, that's the last link on there, www.drawdown.org, or just Google Project Drawdown. There's information on the project, a lot of detail. You have to look around for where to move, but you can find it on the website. And also there's a link to buying the book, which explains it all. I'm hoping this is a growing initiative because it's just so positive, and it's something that we can participate in many, many different ways. A lot of it doesn't require any change in policy. Municipalities and states are not waiting for the U.S. government to take up the initiative and are doing a lot of things, both locally in Pennsylvania and around the nation. California is now looking and will soon be requiring most new homes to have solar panels on their rooftop. California, which has about 10% of our population, if that happens there, as with other things like auto emissions, it will have an impact on the rest of the country. So stay tuned on that one. But again, we need to press for more action. We need to contact our elected representatives and urge them to move on this stuff. And I just want to come back to a second with for a second to the Green New Deal. As I said, it is a nascent idea. I think at this point there are like 13 members of the House and a handful of members in the Senate that are supporting it and backing it. I think that's going to grow. A lot of the new crop of members of the House that were elected in November are strongly behind it, as is Senator Bernie Sanders and a couple other senators. And I think this is going to, I'm hoping we'll get some legs, and part of making it move ahead and work is for us to get on board. But you can Google Green New Deal and see what you can find there. One of the pieces is a jobs guarantee, which is very interesting, and there's something that explains why that's linked. Those of us involved in this believe firmly that moving toward a green economy or making this economy greener will, by its nature, create jobs. So I want to thank you for tuning in. The program next month airs at 10:30 a.m. on January 8th. As with this program, it will be recorded ahead of time because in the short term, I have a conflict that morning. But I will be interviewing Jackie Bonomo from Penn Future, one of the leading organizations fighting climate change and working on environmental issues in Pennsylvania. And Jackie will be coming up from Philadelphia to be my guest the afternoon before. So thank you for tuning in. See you in January.
Building Green on BCTV is supported by BARDA.